is perfectly suited to our local conditions, right? It's powerful enough, and yet it's not overwhelming. It's a relatively light boat, and it's one that a crew of three or four can handle in the typical conditions that we get here in the South Bay. All right. Anything you want me to explain or anything at all, please do shout at any time. One design or handicap, right? I did mention this a moment ago. In one design racing, all of the boats are the same and the racing tends to be very, very close, right? The racing, the results and the success is determined by how well the crew work together rather than how much you spent on your mainsail at the beginning of this season. So they're not always necessarily the most modern boats, but I've spent many years sailing in one design fleets, particularly old European keelboats that are almost 100 years old, right? These are boats that were built in the 1920s and 1930s. And the reason they're competitive is because they're all the same. Now, are they fast compared to a J92 or something like that, a very modern boat? No, they're not. But they all compete well with each other, and that's one of the advantages of the one design race fleet. And the other is you always know your result, right? If you beat somebody on the water in a one design fleet, you know you beat them. You can beat somebody in a handicap fleet, and then somebody goes and gets a spreadsheet out and does the mathematics, and you find out that you didn't beat them overall because handicap fleets work on corrected time. Each boat's finishing time is multiplied by a factor that is intended to take into account how fast or slow that individual boat is. So of course, you can imagine how that goes. If you have a light wind day, some boats outsail their handicap and others are hindered. If you get a heavy wind day, the other boats outsail their handicap and perhaps you get that uncertainty. Whereas with a one design race, you absolutely know where you stand. If you're in front of somebody, it's because you've outsailed them. The Merit 25, I would refer to this, the Merit, as a kind of a crossover between a big boat and a dinghy. It's rigged like a big boat, it carries a spinnaker. During the winter racing, we carry a spinnaker, we handle the sails the same way as we do with a big boat, but frankly, it maneuvers and it is as agile as a dinghy, right? So from the point of view of getting very immediate feedback from the boat, are you doing well, are you not doing well, is the boat accelerating, is the boat slowing down, the Merit is a fantastic choice for racing, and I really cannot recommend it highly enough. It's a fabulous boat, and I don't know where you got them all from, but you made a fantastic choice.
Thanks, yeah.
So, yeah. So, I didn't realize that this wasn't going to show up back here. I have one tip, one specific tip for the Merit 25. Never let go of the main sheet, all right? Because if you do get overpowered, we have a big main and a small jib on the boat. That big main will overpower the rudder. It will heel the boat screws up into wind. Yeah. If you want to be able to maneuver the boat, you have to let the main sheet off in order to be able to maneuver it. That's just something that's specific to this boat and others that are very, very like it. Any questions or anything like that at the moment? All good? Can you hear me okay? Am I enunciate? Can you hear me clearly and all is okay? Doing good? All right. How to win races. That is a Merit 25. That was quite a windy day. Sail with good sail and boat trim. That will help you win races. Trim your sails well, position your crew well on the boat. Sail the least distance, avoid errors. Use wind shifts, etc., etc. Use or avoid the tidal current and so on. And we'll probably cover those a little bit on trim and a little bit on tactics in different seminars that we do, that we plan in the future, Patrick. Patrick's taking notes. All right, and then the bullet five, if you can't read it, it says, understand the rules and avoid taking penalties. A penalty will absolutely move you back down the fleet, no matter how well you did up to the time that you took the penalty. And what I'm going to do in this session, I'm going to explain to you the most essential racing rules. Not in a tremendous amount of detail, because you can get very loyally about the rules if you wish to, right? Just enough to participate and enjoy club racing. So, who makes the rules? WorldSailing.org is, if you like, the committee comprised of members and representatives of sailing nations that publishes the international rule book. So WorldSailing.org is the site, and that's where they are. The U.S. affiliate is U.S. Sailing, not the ASA, the other guys, U.S. Sailing. And And the Racing Rules of Sailing is the rule book that is published every 4 years. Yeah, go ahead. And it looks like this. If you join US Sailing, you get a copy for free. US Sailing membership is about $75 a year. And this is $25 on Amazon, if you want it. This is the rule book and nothing but the rules of sailing in here. Now, it looks thick and intimidating. It isn't. In here is also the rules for racing kite boards, sail boards, match racing, for regatta management, and so on. And therefore, the rules part of this is actually only about the first quarter, and then the rest of it is variations for different kinds of sailing. So we only really need to worry about the first part of this, and we'll pass this around later on, okay? It's published every 4 years. We are currently in the typo version of that, or no, that's right, 2017 to 2020 is the version that we're in right now, 2017 to 2020, yes. And if you have the version that ended in 2017, don't worry. The rules that changed are predominantly around sportsmanship, who does count as a competitor, anti-doping, and stuff that we're just not going to come up against. So if your rule book is the prior version, or somebody offers you a copy that's the prior version, it'll be absolutely fine. We use the same rules for everyone. From those little pram dinghies that they sail across the road here at the Youth Sailing Center, right the way through all of the Olympic classes, right the way up to the America's Cup. Everybody sails by the same set of rules. Okay, so the rules that you know, you've got them, they're good. Race organizations can modify some rules in a document that's called a sailing instruction, and I do have a copy of sailing instructions that Rich uses for Spinnaker. I've got those with me, you know, we can pass those around, and I'll go over some of the key modifications that we have in the Spinnaker sailing instructions that are specific to dodging the hard navigation markers that are out here in Redwood Reach. All right. What about non-racers? That guy didn't have a real good day. He was actually, this is actually a US, sorry, I beg your pardon, a UK Navy boat. And he was a naval officer, and he lost his license over this. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So anyway.
It made a great video.
It did make a really good video. It's not a bad picture. So between racers and there's this, sometimes you'll hear this theory that when you're out racing, other people will keep out your way. It's the opposite. If you're out racing, keep out of everybody else's way, all right? Collision regs apply, so the navigation rules apply. There's an order of priority, which which is published in the navigation rules. Basically, it means that big boats that are constrained in the channel, that can't maneuver easily, when you compare that to a small boat that is sailing, that is maneuverable and nimble, the more agile boat, the boat more able to maneuver, keeps out of the way of the boat less able to maneuver. Now, there's a rule that you might hear spoken by friends and sailing acquaintances that says, but power keeps out of the way of sail. Not in a channel, it doesn't. If you're in a navigational channel, a sailboat, a fishing boat, a small boat must not impede a larger vessel, right? And that is in the rules, and it is absolutely enforced. So we do need to keep out of the way, particularly the bulk carriers and so on that dock further up, that bring in gypsum and take out crushed steel. If they're turning around in the channel, we're postponing the race. It's that simple. We just keep out of the way. All right. Where are we now? Between racing and non-racing sailboats. It was a beautiful day right up until that moment. Racing sailboats, keep out of the way, please, of non-racing sailboats. Okay? The standard rules apply, coal regs apply, then port keeps clear of starboard. Windward keeps clear of leeward. Overtaking boat keeps clear. These are in the coal regs, right? If somebody isn't racing, you can't expect them to adhere to the racing rules. They maybe don't know them. They're not racing. They're not bound by the racing rules that you agree to. You agree to apply the racing rules when you sign up for a race, right? Typically, when you sign on the race sheet, there's a clause on there that says, I agree to be bound by the racing rules of sailing as modified by the club sailing instructions. And you sign up and you agree to race to the rules. People who are out there just out for sale, they haven't signed that, but they are bound by coal regs. OK? Okay, so port keeps clear of starboard, windward keeps clear of leeward, and the overtaking boat keeps clear, straight out of the collision regulations. Any questions? All good so far? Yep. No, no, keep going. Great, okay. Typical race courses. There are two kinds of race courses that we'll encounter when we go racing. This is what's called a mark set course. Some guy in a whaler straps three or four of these onto the back of the whaler and holds onto them, and they go out into open water and they set marks. They strive to make sure that the windward mark is directly upwind of the start line, the leeward mark is directly downwind of the windward mark, and they'll move them around to make sure that that race course has perfect windward-leeward orientation. Or there's what we do, which is called around the cats, which is we use those convenient markers that either Sequoia Sailing Club or the government have left out there, right? And we just go out and we race around those which give us the best approximation of a windward-leeward course. Okay? So let's walk through a typical race sailing here at Spinnaker. So, first, how do you get involved? Call the office and sign up. Call and speak to Dana or speak to Donata or whoever's at the office and say, hey, I'm a member here. I'd like to be involved in the racing. If you're qualified to race, if we know who you are and we're good with your skills, then you can sign up as a skipper, or if you want to be signed up as a crew, we'll do our best to match you up with somebody who will take care of you and give you a good introduction to sailing. Check in at the office about an hour before the start. As skippers, you get a boat number that is drawn at random, merits 1 through 14. You don't know which boat you're going to get, right? So it's no good coming down here on a Thursday night and scrubbing the bottom, right, of merit number such and whichever one you had the previous week, because you're not going to get that boat the following week, right? And the intent of doing that is that any minor differences between boats in the fleet are randomized by that, and that nobody gets a continuing advantage or disadvantage because they've got the same boat in succession. Okay, bring warm clothes and snacks. Winter is calm. We say here it's the exact opposite of what you'd expect. In the winter, we race in shorts and t-shirts, and during the summer, we race in foul weather gear, right? And the reason for that is our local sea breeze. It comes thundering in over the hills at usually about 11 o'clock in the morning. And by the time we race in the evening, there can be a good solid 10 to 14 knots with gusts maybe up to 18 to 20, which is a fantastic sailing breeze. It's an exhilarating sailing breeze. And once we get out of the shoulders of the, as we get into the winds at the moment, except for this week, which is weather system, the winds during the winter are typically light. Spring and autumn are brisk, summer is windy. Okay, so the warmer the weather, this is the odd thing. The hotter it is in the Central Valley, the windier it's going to be here. So the hotter the weather chart, the weather map, the weather forecast gives you on the, after the news, at the end of the news in the evening, the hotter they say it's going to be, the colder we'll be out racing because it's going to be windier. And of course these boats, they take water over the deck. Right, we do get a little bit of splashing once we're out and trying to make the boats go fast. So come ready for the weather. Join your crew and pepper boat. Skipper will take you through a safety check and assign roles on the boat. My recommendation is leave the dock no less than 30 minutes before the start time. It lets you settle into your role on the boat, gives you time to get out to the start line and be ready to start racing. So let's look at a typical race. This is the outer end of our channel here, and what we've got here is this is marker 6, 5, etc., marker 2, marker 12, right? And we'll typically set a race course that has a start line out the end of the channel up to marker 12. We say up to marker 12 because usually the wind is coming down from the northwest. Up to 12, turn around 12, back to the channel, race home, finish just out of here, usually at marker 20. Okay, so here's our starting area. We sail out to the end of the channel, up to 12, turn around it. In this case, we've gone down to Sequoia Mark. This is Sequoia Mark Y, more or less. They just moved it. Then back to the channel and back down again. So that would be very, very typical of what we'll do in an evening race in 12 knots or more of wind. Okay? So, fundamental rules. We'll talk about the duck and the always assist those in danger. Okay, fundamental maritime rule is if you see somebody in trouble, give them a hand. Always wear your PFD. Compete in compliance with recognized principles of sportsmanship and fair play. That comes straight out of the rule book. I promise, that's not how I talk normally. Learn the rules and sail by them. Accept your penalties. If you make a mistake, take your penalty. Seriously. Sailing is self-policing, so we hold ourselves to the standards that we want to sail to. Okay? There's no referees out there. There's no umpire. There's no guy in a stripy shirt with a whistle and a little flag that he can throw up. There's no coaches' challenges. There's nothing like that. We hold ourselves to the standards that we want to sail to. Right? And you'll note that different clubs have a different tone. Some of them are very, you know, competitive, and some skippers get the red mist, and there's a lot of, you know, raised voices on boats. Others are tremendously mellow. Our goal is to be a welcoming club where people advance and they enjoy racing in a friendly manner. Rich, back me up if there's anything I'm missing.
You spot on.
Relax and have fun, because we're racing for rubber ducks. These are the prizes for winning races. You put your bag, your hand in a grab bag that Brett holds out, and what usually comes out is either a whistle or a rubber duck. So that's the...
Andrew, how do you define danger?
Say again?
How do you define danger? Always assist
those in danger. If you see a boat that is sinking, on fire, you see somebody in the water, you'll know it. It's like, you know what they say, you'll know it when you see
what
it.
What about
like
seriously run aground?
It's like pornography, you'll know when you see it.
Well, what about seriously run aground?
Somebody who's aground is typically not in danger, okay? I mean, they're in trouble because they're not going to be home in time for dinner, right? But they're not necessarily
in danger.
They're in trouble with Rich, but they're not in danger. They're not necessarily in danger. So that doesn't mean you stop racing to try and tow somebody off the putty. You wouldn't do that. Right? But if you see a boat that's been dismasted, there's a possibility that somebody's been injured. If you're out there and you see a dinghy that's drifting down and is upside down and there's some kid with his arms wrapped around the centerboard, go give him a hand. Yeah? Nothing more than that. So it's basic maritime courtesy.
That's it. In doubt, you can always ask.
Say again?
You can always ask.
If in doubt, go and ask. Now, here's the thing. If you stop racing in order to give somebody a hand, whether they need it or not, you will be given redress by the race committee. So the race committee will give you either as a finishing, even if you come in dead last 2 hours later behind everybody else, if you were in third place when you stopped to help, you will either get a third place for that race, or you will get your average position for the series, depending on which redress method that your club uses, right? So there is never a penalty for rendering assistance. Yeah, don't think that you're gonna toss a race series or anything like that because you go help somebody. You can enjoy the warm glow of having gone and helped somebody. Okay, any other questions on that one?